Siobhain McDonagh, and I am the MP for Mitcham Morden. And the reason why I'm playing with my phone is not just because it's what we all do, but I have late yesterday afternoon, I had an email from the owner of the site.
Cameron Bay.
His legal representatives.
Ah.
Okay. Great. We've got Councillor Ian Munn here from Cricket Green Ward, who's been doing a lot of work, and Mr. Kissy, who's Director of Environment and Regeneration at Merton Council, for his sins. At some point, must have been quite great. On the 4th of August, I wrote to both the Council of Italy and to Mr. Baig and Phoenix Properties, the owners, to ask them if they could come and meet us here today. Mr. Lee agreed, and he will be able to tell us what the current position is with the council. But what I wanted to do was just read to you the email I got from the owner's legal representatives last night. We wrote to them, as I said, on the 4th of August, and we managed to track them down by phone yesterday. Whereupon they told us that they weren't able to come this morning and that they were quite far advanced in negotiation to sell the site to a housing association. They couldn't tell me which housing association. They claimed not to remember the name. Now, this is the letter, this is the email I got from Phoenix legal representatives last night at 5:45. Dear Madam, we act on behalf of Phoenix GRP Investments Limited, who are the registered proprietors of the above property. Our clients have forwarded to us a copy of your letter dated the 7th of August, requesting a meeting on the 12th of September. We write to inform you that our clients will not be attending the meeting on the 12th of September, as they have received and accepted an offer of a sale of the site to a housing association. The housing association intends to develop the site for residential accommodation, and as such, their offer is conditional upon planning permission being granted for a minimum number of flats to make the transaction financially viable for the housing association to proceed. We understand that your secretary spoke to Mr. Mustafa of our client company yesterday, who notified her of the sale. As part of the sale, it is intended that the club building will also be refurbished. This will obviously then alleviate the concerns of your constituents. We understand the architects are being instructed to prepare initial drawings with a view to submitting a formal planning application within the next few weeks. We can keep you updated in relation to the sale should you require. And that's Maxim Solicitors of Grant of Gants Hill, Essex. So that's the correspondent from the owner.
I'll pick up on two or three issues. Firstly, on the issue about the potential for it to be sold to a housing association. It would be inappropriate for me to speculate, but we do know that there have been discussions between the owner and the housing association. So there may be some mileage in that, there may be some genuine truth in that, and let's hope that's the case, because clearly it's not running as a viable proposition, and a housing use may well be very appropriate. It would need to have a planning application, so there needs to be full and proper consultation, and we'll see how that planning application plays. Two issues that we're dealing with as much force as we can. Firstly, the unauthorised sale of vehicles where we're standing. We've taken planning enforcement action. A notice has been served. That notice has expired. And unless the vehicles are cleared by the 20th of October, then we'll be able to take legal action in the courts in order to enforce that. The second issue is the condition of the building, which is a listed building. We've taken planning enforcement on that. We've served the appropriate notices. And the key date is that it requires the owners to submit a planning and listed building application by the 27th of October, and then allows them 5 months to complete the works to bring it back up to the required standard. If they don't do that, then it allows us to enforce and ultimately CPO, to purchase the building if they haven't taken the appropriate action. So we're doing everything within the council's powers to deal with both the unauthorised sale of the vehicles and the condition of the building, and we hope that the owners do the right thing in terms of clearing the car park and bringing the property back into a proper condition. From what Siobhain's saying, it sounds like they're pursuing a line now of looking at a new owner and a new development opportunity, and it may well be that that's the route that they take, but I know no more than that at this point in time.
On a personal level, I find it hard to believe that if the housing association really knew the restrictions on the site, that it would be financially viable for them to do this. Now, I'm only saying that from a purely, I don't know this, but a purely speculative thing, but, you know, the pub is going to be, take cost quite a lot of money to make into proper state. It's not very convertible to accommodation. The cricket pavilion, it's a cricket pavilion, it's not going to become flat. And so the space that there is to develop is pretty limited.
But you're not kind of replacing that as
If I may, I'm the chairman of the cricket club. My last conversation with Cameron, he indicated to me that he was no longer in discussion with Traveller, but that he was considering flats on the back car park.
It's beyond the back fence.
At that point in time, he was wanting to have us consider the possibility of moving the pavilion onto the playing surface. I had to explain to him that we were not the owners, that it's common land and it would require an Act of Parliament in order to undertake that, and left it with him to pursue that if he chose to. But we made it very, very clear to him that we have just and are continuing to undertake refurbishment works on the pavilion. We spent £20,000 in doing that, not with the intention of going away. We've had a reasonably successful season and we would intend to be here next year and hopefully forever.
But if the council compulsory purchase thing, you said the other night that you'd go in partnership with someone, and that'd probably be a housing
project. The council, if it were to compulsory purchase of land, would need to go into partnership with another party. That he would make sure that the British pavilion is secure. I think no way that that's a risk for the council, that's the risk.
So would we be offered to buy it?
First thing I'd say is that compulsory purchase would not be our objective. That's a power that we can use, but it's a very blunt tool. It's quite tortuous. It requires certain legal steps, and you can often get tied up in legal knots. I think Councilman's absolutely right. Where we have entered into a CPO, we've often had, always had a back-to-back deal with an onward developer, because we're not in the process of developing pubs as a council. So we wouldn't want it to be in our ownership more than for a minute, whilst we then had a back-to-back deal with another organisation. The community right to bid, which I think is what you're referring to also, wouldn't apply, because we wouldn't be owning the pub for any period of time. It would be immediately sold off. But let's not run away with that. We're dealing with it as per the prescribed timescale.
I think the timescale has been breached. I'm not entirely sure, but I think it may be certainly on the wire with it. So.
I know we're dealing with it, and we've always dealt with it in the prescribed timescale.
Okay. Process.
I mean, how is this going to affect? I mean, are the processes you've put in place, will they be affected by this? What's coming in? Somebody doing this?
Our enforcement action on the car park and on the building will progress.
Right.
So, and it may be because of that we're seeing some momentum in terms of
discussions with others.
That will continue with the new owners if it's taken over by a Burn Housing
Association. I think...
Well, you have to start a new process then.
I'd need to check that. If after the end of the 2 months he hasn't done that, the 5 months rate is not
If we could also just... well, we'll come to you just in a second.
No, so can they speak up?
Okay, shall we all come in a little bit closer together?
Like we all like one another.
We're all friends.
The listed building repairs notice would not be affected by the sale. And if within 2 months of the service of the listed building repairs notice, Cameron hasn't brought forward an application to identify ways in which he could carry out the repairs to that building, the 5 months grace could happen, would be put in the group. We would then have to consider going to the secretary and say for permission to compulsory process with a given sooner than the 5 months grace period.
There are a
couple of... I think we're just
Hanging down with the building. There'll never be a path.
Well, the first thing is it's not the council's building, so no. We're relying upon the owner.
When this fellow bought it, he must have had an idea in his mind. Yeah?
I don't think he understood what he thought.
He was going to knock it all down.
Yeah, they didn't understand what he thought.
When I first met Cameron here about 2.5 years ago, his intention was to demolish that, demolish this, and put up the most disgusting design. Hotel building to ever see. He hadn't realised that he was in the kitchen. He bought 3 pubs, sight unseen,
Surely the landlord has an obligation.